Exodus chapter 13, starting in verse 17, and it says, "And it came to pass, when Pharaoh had let the people go, that God led them not through the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. For God said, lest peradventure the people repent when they see war, and they return to Egypt. But God led the people about through the way of the wilderness of the Red Sea, and the children of Israel went up harnessed out of the land of Egypt. And Moses took the bones of Joseph with him, for he had straitly sworn the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you, and ye shall carry up my bones away hence with you. And they took their journey from Succoth, and encamped in Etham in the edge of the wilderness. And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of a cloud to lead them the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light to go by day and night. And he took not away the pillar of the cloud by day, nor the pillar of the fire by night from before the people." Let's go ahead. Last week we looked at Moses a little bit, when God has him going to Pharaoh, and in that tell Pharaoh that he's going to lead the children of Israel out. And I sort of touched on it some last week. We know what happens from there. Pharaoh refuses. God sends the plagues. Pharaoh says, you know, okay, if you'll remove the plague, I'll let him go. God removes the plague. Pharaoh stiffens his neck again, and so on and so on. It goes over and over until finally God sends where all the firstborn die, and Pharaoh says, okay, go. But now, think about this for a minute. As I was studying this out over this last little bit, Moses has done as God commanded him. He's gone to Pharaoh. Like he was told to go. He has gone to Pharaoh. He has obeyed what God told him to do. He has said what God told him to say. But now he has a huge task ahead of him of leading this people. I don't know, maybe I'm the only one. I've always thought, you know, boy, the hardest part for Moses in all this would have been going and dealing with Pharaoh. But I think leading the people would have been a lot more difficult. This would have been a huge task. I don't know how people come up with these numbers, so if this isn't correct, I don't know one way or the other. But I read this week where they said they figured out that Moses led 600,000 people out of Egypt. 600,000. Let me give you a little perspective. This is a list of major U.S. cities with population around 600,000. Detroit, El Paso, Seattle, Denver, Washington, D.C., Memphis, Boston, Nashville, Baltimore, Oklahoma City, Portland, Las Vegas. There's piles of others. When you start looking at it in those terms, that's huge. I mean, can you imagine Detroit is the one that kind of keeps sticking in my head. Can you imagine going into Detroit and saying, okay, people, follow me. I want everyone in the city to pack up and grab what you can carry. It's moving day. You know, trying to lead that many people, when you think of it that way, it makes, brings up a whole lot of issues and difficulties that Moses would have had. It makes the fact that there is murmurings and disputings as they go a lot more understandable, because of course one man won't be able to address the problems of the entire city of Detroit. But even setting aside the issues of just the masses, you have some aspects that are going to make this a very difficult job. Consider, where are we going? You know, when you see in chapter 3, when God tells Moses to go, God tells Moses that he's going to take him out of Egypt in the land of the Canaanites, Jebusites, all the other ites. You start studying it, that doesn't really narrow it down a whole lot. Those people lived all over the place. In essence, here's what he's telling Moses. You're going to take them out of Egypt and go that way.
Amen.
That's what he's saying. That's going to be a really hard sell to anyone. To Abraham, having to explain to his wife and to Lot and to his servants. But Abraham wasn't leading over 500,000 people. Moses here is leading well over 500,000 people and saying, okay, I'm your leader, let's go, but I don't know where. That's going to be difficult. And then, you know, you consider things like, how are we going to get there? The passage where we started reading makes it clear that God took them the way that he did on purpose. It's a war-ravaged land, which really hasn't changed much over the years in between now and then. You know, we're talking about a place where there is constant battle, and so it says that God took them purposely the way he did, because if they went the way that would have been the straighter way, they would have gotten scared of all the wars. So he takes them a different way. But you're talking, they're going through a war-ravaged land, and this isn't exactly an army that Moses is leading. The vast majority of people would have been women and children, and the men that he did have were servants, not trained fighters. Going through a war-ravaged land would have just meant that they would have been the victim of whoever they came across, whoever they happen to cross paths with. So instead, God's plan is we're going to get there going through the wilderness. And I know wilderness here is different than wilderness there. I get that. But I'm enough of an outdoors person that I can understand wilderness. And there are times it's hard for me to go through wilderness, let alone leading 500,000 plus people. It was a few years back now. If my wife is listening in the nursery, she asked me, "Do you have any stories of me in your message?" I told her, "I don't think so." I was wrong. I do have one, at least one. It was a few years back now. We decided that we were going to, instead of going to like a U-cut place or something like that for our Christmas tree, the Meads and our family, we were going to go out in the woods and get a Christmas tree, and which was a fun experience. But so we got the permit and all that you have to get, and we're headed out there and start driving through, you know, the snow-covered dirt and gravel roads to get there. And I'm an easy-to-please person. First tree I saw on the side of the road, I was like, "There it is. Let's cut that thing down and go home." My wife was not so. We drove and drove and drove and drove. So far at one point that there was so much snow we couldn't drive anymore, so we had to turn around and go a different way. We drove and drove and drove, and finally she said, "There it is." So I stopped and thought, you know, great, we finally found it, and looked where she was pointing. And you can ask her, this is not an exaggeration. Where she was pointing was way off down the distance across two rivers. Not an exaggeration, across two rivers. So here we go, the Meads. Aaron, Carrie, Lisa, and I, at the time, four kids in tow, with chainsaws over shoulder, to cross the rivers. It was Aaron and I stood in the middle of the river passing people across to get them across the two rivers. We finally get to the tree, and she says, "Yes, this is the one." Which is probably a really good thing, because had I gone through all that and she'd been like, "It's ugly now they see it," I wouldn't have been happy. But so we cut it down thinking, okay, but then have to do the whole thing in reverse, packing two Christmas trees out. And as much of a pain as that was only eight people. Yeah. Imagine that was 600,000. This is not going to be easy terrain. This isn't going to be a paved trail. This is going to be hard. This is going to be a difficult path. Then you consider things like food. You just brought 600,000 people. They may have packed a lot of stuff. I don't know how much they brought. They may have packed a lot of stuff, but I guarantee they didn't pack enough to sustain that many people for very long. I'm confident when Moses said we're headed through the wilderness, that the thought went through a bunch of minds: what are we going to eat on this way? I work with teenagers all the time. We don't get 10 minutes down the road and one of them says, "When are we stopping for food?" Yeah. I guarantee one of the kids on this trip said, "Moses, when's the first food break?" Yeah. Where are we eating? This is going to be difficult. This is going to be hard. And then you consider things like, what do we do when we get there? You know, call me crazy, but I doubt that all of the people who live in the land are going to be thrilled to give away their land. And in 600,000 people, I'm confident that many thought, and probably even many vocalized that, what are we going to do when we get there, Moses? Moses, we aren't fighters, and they aren't going to just leave their land because we walked in. This task that Moses just started was going to be was going to be a difficult task. A lot more difficult than just going and talking to Pharaoh would have been. And Moses didn't think he could handle that part of it. What's he going to do here? But here's the deal. God didn't say, good job, Moses. You did what I said. You got the people out of Egypt. Now the people are free. Good luck. No, he said, you did what I said. Now I'll lead you as you go. Passages that we read, verse 21, the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of a cloud to lead them the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, to go by day and by night. He's leading them as they go. I've mentioned this through this series. When God says go, when he has somewhere he wants us to go, or when he has something he wants us to do, some action that he wants us to do, he leads the way. He doesn't leave us to figure it out on our own, to fend for ourselves. He leads the way. But I want us to focus on this tonight. He doesn't always lead the same way. He doesn't always lead the same way. There are some people who have the mentality that everything should be the same every single time, which would be nice, but it isn't reality. Think of your kids. I try very hard to raise my kids, all three of them, exactly the same way. I don't know that I succeed at it. Lisa tells me that I am way easier on Kaylee than I am on the boys, but I try to raise them all the same. But regardless of if I treat them all the same, they are not the same at all. Zach's personality at 3 years old is way different than Josh or Kaylee's personalities were at three. Josh at three was a piece of cake. He was super laid back and easygoing. Kaylee at three was an angry little child that pitched fits over her car seat, fought sleeping, and hated men. If a guy other than myself or my dad looked at her, she screamed. I mean, she was an angry little kid. Zach is just busy. He's always doing something. It would be nice if they were all the same, but in reality, that doesn't happen. The same is true with God's leading. Doesn't always lead the same. Different situations, he leads differently. So here's what I want us to do tonight. With that in mind, I want us to look at three examples in the Bible of different ways that God leads. The first is the supernatural way. As our passage tonight, verse 21, we just looked at, talking about the pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire. You think about this, there is nothing that you can call being led by a pillar of cloud and a pillar of fire. Nothing you can call that except for supernatural. That's not normal. It's not your everyday occurrence. I don't know exactly how big it was. I've heard some say that, I read a thing this week that said, you know, it was probably only 4 to 5 feet tall, and they tried to compare it to, like, when you look at forest fires, the wind blows just right, you get like this little wind tunnel thing, and it'll be, you know, 4 to 6 feet tall, you know, it looks like a tornado. Here's the difficulty I see with that, and maybe I'm oversimplifying this, here's the difficulty I see with that: it's leading 600,000 people. Amen. It's going to have to be big. Again, think of the city of Seattle, right around 600,000 people. If you're going to build something that the entire city of Seattle could see, it would have to be huge. The Space Needle, you can't see. And part of this is because the terrain of streets of Seattle, I understand that, but you can't see it from everywhere in Seattle. And it's huge. For this pillar of fire and pillar of smoke to be followed by all of the people, it's going to have to be seen by all of the people, which means it's going to be massive. That's God leading supernaturally. It's God leading in an obvious way. In an obvious way that they can see, hey, that's not normal. This is God. It's not the only time that God leads them in an obvious way. Think of the Red Sea crossing when they're backed up to the Red Sea with enemy coming at them. You have, again, over 500,000 people saying, what are we going to do? Where are we going to go? We're going to die. And then the sea opens a path to cross. It's going to be pretty obvious to say, I think God wants us to go that way. Yeah. I mean, you know, that's That's pretty obvious. It doesn't take a spiritual giant to recognize God might be doing something here. He just opened a path across the ocean. You know, that's going to be pretty obvious. And at times, that's how God leads in our lives. In ways that, you know, maybe not a pillar of fire and a sea spreading wide open for us, but in ways that are obvious they're God. Ways that we can easily describe as supernatural. Ways that we can see and say, God did that. I know personally I've had those times in my life where I can clearly say God led in an obvious way, or God has worked in this in an obvious way. And let's be honest, that's our favorite way for God to lead us. Because that leaves no doubt. There's no mistaking when the sea opens up that's the direction I'm supposed to go. Leaves no doubt. There's no question that this is from God. There's no confusion over what should be done. Again, there's a trail going across the Red Sea. It's obvious this is the way you go. You know, if you turn to the right or left, you're swimming. It's pretty obvious. You just keep walking this way. When you're following a giant pillar of fire and smoke, there's not much question. The miraculous pillar of fire went forward. We should too. You know, that seems pretty obvious. But God doesn't always lead the same. Sometimes He leads in supernatural ways. Sometimes He leads, through, I'll word it this way, simple servants. A lot of times God leads in our lives through people. Think of Moses. Since this is the passage that we're in, it makes sense to start here. Moses, led of God, is being used to lead God's people. Moses, in and of himself, is nothing special. He says that repeatedly. He points out his own faults. He's just a willing servant. He isn't leading this nation because of anything that he is or any great skill that he possesses. He isn't chosen by God because the upbringing he had or because the training he had in Pharaoh's house. He's just a willing servant. People aren't following Moses because he can build a great crowd or because, again, his skills are so amazing that they just naturally are drawn to him. Moses is just a simple servant that God's using to lead the nation. Another example that I think of is Gideon. Or you could look at any of the judges in the Bible. Of themselves, they're nothing special, just simple, willing servants. Used of God to lead His people. Last week I mentioned Gideon. I was getting ahead of myself in the series. I knew I shouldn't have when I said it, and I did anyways last week. But Gideon was nothing special and knew it. He over and over tells God that he's the wrong man for the job. He tries to convince God, you've made a mistake. You can't possibly be looking for me. Because he knew he was nothing. And then you look at Gideon's army was nothing. It's a bunch of untrained men, most of which God filtered out and sent home. Of themselves, they were nothing, yet God used them to get a major victory. They were used to lead the people. Why? Because they were simple, willing servants. Another example that we could look at is pastors, or in Bible times you could look at prophets as, or a pastor like Moses, just like Gideon, is nothing on our own. Simply willing servants. Because of that, it's one of the ways that God often uses to lead us. You can ask my dad. I come to him quite often about decisions, probably more than most people because he's my dad and my pastor. And most of the time when I come to him, I just talk to him, talking to my dad. Every now and then, though, I will come to him and say, I need your advice, or I need to talk to you as my pastor. I need to talk to my pastor for a few minutes. And when I do, I don't take lightly what he has to say. I do when he's just my dad. But when he's my pastor, when I'm talking to him as my pastor, I take that seriously. I'm kidding. But I don't take it lightly what he says, because I believe God put him there to be one of the ways that God leads me. God leads me. God leads us through our pastor, through preaching. When God speaks to you through a message that pastor or I preach, that's God leading you through a man. God leads me through him through advice or counsel. My dad is not quick to throw out counsel. I don't know if that's true with everyone. Toward me, he's not quick to throw out his counsel. But when he does, I ought to make sure to listen. Because it's God leading through a willing man. He leads through example. And this is me personally talking for a moment. Everybody leads through example. Example of how to live as a Christian. Example of how to have a good marriage, how to raise your kids. Very often, that's how God leads in our lives, through a man, through a simple, willing servant. The third way I want us to see tonight, sometimes God leads through supernatural ways, supernaturally. Sometimes he leads through simple servants. And the third way I want us to see tonight is sometimes he leads, and quite often he leads, through the still small voice. 1 Kings 19, verse 11 and 12, it says, "And he said, Go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind rent the mountains and brake in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in a fire. And after the fire, a still small voice." We like it when God leads in that supernatural way. The pillar of fire type of way. We like that. Again, like I said earlier, that's easy. We can see exactly what he's doing. We can see right where he's leading, and there's no question this is from God. We, most of the time, are even okay when God leads us through a man. Again, it's visible. You can see it. It's easier to follow. But very often in our lives, the way that God leads us is not that supernatural, that obvious way. It's not always through a man. It's often simply speaking to us. Now, I think of Samuel. God speaks to him while he's sleeping, and he immediately runs to the man of God and asks what he said. And this happens a few times before they figure out that it was God that was talking to him. Now, it would have been easy to have gone and followed the man of God. He was in front of him. He could see him. And that's what he had, to this point, done all his life anyways. He was used to following orders. He was used to following the example. This is new. This is different. This is harder. But quite often when God leads, he leads by that still small voice. We have a lot of teens right now learning to drive, so it reminded me of this. When Bo learned to drive, and then when I later learned to drive, I love seeing the progression of my parents through this. My mom, when Bo learned to drive, was a wreck. She at least seemed super nervous about Bo driving. I can't remember any time that Bo was driving with my mom in the car that she was not holding the little handle, gripping with her knuckles white. I mean, she was a wreck every time that Bo drove, and as a little brother, it was really funny to watch. My dad, when Bo was learning to drive, was even better, because my dad, when Bo was learning, would carry around an empty 2-liter bottle of Coke, and he just left it in the car, eventually, that he would hold on to, and while Bo was driving, if Bo did something that might have killed us, my dad, while Bo was trying to get through it, would be beating him with the empty 2-liter bottle of Coke. Again, as a little brother, it was great to watch. I had a great time with it. Follow me here. I compare both of those, in my mind, to that supernatural leading. Really obvious. Really obvious, you know, big fire type of leading. When you're getting beat with a 2-liter bottle, it's pretty obvious I've done something wrong. I mean, you know, it's really obvious. When I began to drive, my mom had calmed down substantially. I still much preferred riding with my dad because it was obvious she was scared. She just didn't make it as vocal. Riding or learning with her was, for me, more like that simple servant. She still got pretty nervous and spent most of the time holding that little handle, but gave simple, normally quiet, step-by-step directions. My dad, when I was learning, was by far my favorite. Most of the time, my dad just took a nap. I'll never forget when I first got my permit. I hadn't had it a month, and we went to Hood River, and I got on I-5, and he laid his chair back and said, "Okay, I'm going to take a nap. Just keep on this road. I'll wake up before we have to take a turn." I thought, "I'm going down Interstate 5. You have to be kidding me." But it was true. He woke up before we had to take an exit, so it worked. But my dad, what he would do, he was always very calm when I was, as far as I remember, when I was driving, my dad was always very calm. But when we had those near crash experiences, he would just calmly say, "Had I been driving, I would have handled that differently." Every time, it was a line real similar to that. If I would have been driving, this is what I would have done there, rather than almost hit that car, or, you know, something like that. His leading was by, if you will, that still small voice, that kind of not so obvious in your face, not so step-by-step direction, just, if I had been doing this, here's what you should have done. Now, here's the point of all this. When God tells us go, when God directs us that He has something He wants us to do, He will always lead us. Sometimes it's in ways that are unmistakable. Ways like the pillar of fire or the Red Sea parting. Ways that you cannot miss. Sometimes it's through others that He's using to lead us. Sometimes it's through simply speaking to us, but He's always leading us. The key is simply this, that we look and listen for His leading. When God tells us to go, He's always leading. We just need to be looking and listening for it. Because if we're not, quite often we miss the pillar of fire. I think often we go through life like the children of Israel, except for when that pillar of fire is there, we're going, "I don't see a pillar of fire. Nothing there." We're not looking for it. God's wanting to lead. God's wanting to show us the way. God says, "I want you to go here, and I'm going to show you how." We're just not paying attention for it. When God says go, when God wants us to do something for Him, He will always lead. We just need to look and listen for His leading. Let's pray.